So I want to talk about Kiro, which is an SSA-based intermediate representation that we designed specifically for quantum program optimization. And Torsten already mentioned that we had some collaborators from Microsoft, Thomas Hanner and Vadim Plishnikov. And of course, Torsten supervised this as well. So let's jump into this. To start with, I want to briefly introduce IRs and then look at the existing IRs that exist in the quantum space already. So intermediate representations, or IRs, that they actually fulfill multiple functions. And the big one is being an intermediate step for translation, which greatly minimizes the number of translators one has to write between different programming languages and processor architectures. But more importantly, it aids in program analysis and optimization. So compared to source code, you can think of an IR as containing the program and being augmented with information gathered during analysis. And this stuff is stored in data structures that make it much easier to transform the program and speed up compilation and optimization processes. So what we wanted to look at was, what should an IR look like such that it optimally supports compilation and optimization tasks in the quantum domain going forward? Let's look at existing quantum programming frameworks and identify IRs that they use. There's Project Q, for example, which was developed here at ETH. And while it contributed some great ideas for near-term compilation of quantum programs, it doesn't really have a central IR. Instead, gates or quantum instructions are individually fed through a pipeline of compiler modules. And each of them is responsible to store the instructions that they receive. There's also Q-Sharp, which was developed by Microsoft, and originally it didn't have an IR either. Of course, last year, Microsoft came out with a new quantum IR based on LVM, which they call QIR, and I think they plan to integrate this with Q-Sharp. And while it goes in a similar direction as our work, and that is making use of a powerful classical IR to represent quantum programs at a higher level abstraction than quantum circuits, LVM also has some downsides, mainly due to its rigidity. Qiskit primarily uses a directed acyclic graph as its central IR, at least for optimization. It's great at representing circuits, but it's not so good for high-level abstraction. So the acyclical nature, for example, prevents complex control flow and measurement feedback and things like that. But there's also quantum assembly languages, such as Open and Cosm, developed by IBM. But I think these are primarily used to interface with the hardware. So I don't know of any compilers that directly operate on this representation. Circ by Google similarly uses the DAG, or just a list of gates organized by time slices. And so what we notice is that we accept, with the exception of QIR, analysis and transformation is only performed once the circuit is generated from a classical program. And to illustrate the downside of this approach, let me show you how a program is compiled in Qiskit. We start out with a classical program written in Python, and it contains instructions on how to generate this quantum circuit. In this example, we have a quantum Fourier transform, and the program is written in a general way to work on any number of qubits. And we can see it employs some classical control flows, such as for loops. Now, if we want to compile this, and we hit the first problem in that we can't continue the process without specifying the size of the circuit. Okay, so we provide a circuit size, and we then execute this classical function in Python, and this will generate a circuit for us in the form of a list of quantum instructions. Now, crucially, all the classical control flow is gone, and the size of the program representation increase dramatically in the matter depends on the parameters of the program. So in this case, the number of qubits for this QFT. After this, the circuit is transformed into a DAG, and this is where all the optimizations are performed in Qiskit in what they call the transpiler. And eventually it's compiled down to OpenCASM. So the takeaway here is that in order to compile this program in Qiskit, we had to specify the program parameters. We lost all the classical program structure in the process of generating the circuit, and this increased the program size. which increases the computational requirements for analyzing and optimizing this program. So these previous approaches, they work well for small near-term quantum programs, but we quickly run into problems if we consider application scale programs. So this could be 10 to the 10 or 10 to the 15 gates in our circuit. So with that in mind, a quantum intermediate presentation for application scale computing should do the following. It should provide a unified representation for classical and quantum program parts, and it should enable optimization on quantum programs on this high level description, that is before classical program resolution. It should support state-of-the-art optimization algorithms, both classical and quantum, and maybe even enable synergies between them. And wherever possible, it should reuse existing computation infrastructure, not only to avoid unnecessary work, but also to draw on the experience of compiler design in the classical domain. And finally, it should provide a simple mechanism to lower existing programming languages to this IR. So last year, there's a new compiler infrastructure that emerged from a team at Google called MLIR, or Multi-Level Intermediate Representation. And shares a lot of similarities with LLVM in that it's SSA-based, but it differs in a fundamental way, and that is extensibility. So while LLVM is somewhat rigid, in MLIR, you can easily define extensions via dialects, which contain new operations with custom semantics, new types, and so on. But still, it provides this common infrastructure for the optimizations for analysis and for lowering the programs. So the reason that MLIR is a multi-level intermediate representation is that you can simultaneously represent multiple extraction levels and also multiple application domains. So whereas in something like GCC, you would have a high level IR and then a low level IR where the entire program is translated from one to the other. In MLIR, you can selectively lower parts of the program from different abstraction levels. And so this makes it ideal for a purpose of designing a domain-specific quantum intermediate representation that represents mixed classical quantum programs. So let's look at the IR that we designed using MLIR. This is a compilation stack as we envision it for our IR. You start at the top with a high-level quantum programming languages. And then we designed two dialects with different semantics. So the first dialect, which is the input dialect, and it's labeled quantum in this diagram, it features the same semantics as these high-level program languages. And this simplifies the translation. Then there's a second dialect, which is focused on optimization, and this is labeled quantum SSA here. And what it does is it exposes the data flow of the quantum instructions in the SSA graph of the representation. And this allows us to integrate the quantum program nicely in all the infrastructure that's in place with MLIR. Classical program portions are translated into appropriate MLIR dialects that already exist. And then at the backend level, we can also leverage existing infrastructure such as LLVM to generate executables for simulators or for resource estimation, as well as for like a quantum runtime that would actually execute the program on quantum hardware in conjunction with classical hardware. So what do these quantum dialects actually look like? The input dialect features what we call memory semantics. And there we have unique qubit references, and the operations act on it on these qubits via side effects. So there's an MLIR program here. Let me briefly explain the different elements. You have operations that interact with SSA values. So the SSA values are represented with these percentage symbols. And the operations are highlighted in blue here. They feature a dialect prefix to distinguish different dialects. And they also have this type information for input values and output values of operations. You can also have some constants, such as this rotation angle for this rotation instruction. Now, the memory semantics, what they mean is that we have this qubit reference that was generated here when we allocated a qubit, and we use the same reference throughout the entire program. So the, for example, the multiplication instruction, which would take in two values and produce a new value, this doesn't happen with these quantum instructions. So that's why they act via side effects. Now, in contrast, in the optimization dialect, we use value semantics. So we have a form of quantum SSA. So here, every operation, it consumes a quantum state value and then produces a new quantum state. And what this does is that the operations are now linked in the SSA graph by these useDef chains. So a value use, such as this one here, is linked to the definition of that value, linking these two operations together in the SSA graph. So this is the structure of these dialects, of these quantum dialects that we designed. We have some data types for qubits, of course, and qubit registers, and also data types for quantum operations. And this allows us to treat these operations as first-class objects and modify them with other operations. So we have operations that do qubit management. We have operations that implement an instruction set. And we have these MID operations, which modify existing operations in some way by adding control qubits or adding or computing the adjoint of an operation, so the inverse. And we also have support for user-defined quantum operations via in the form of quantum functions. Now, before moving on, I kind of want to emphasize the difference in paradigm between existing compilers and our approach, and that is the static versus dynamic compilation system. So in NIST-focused tools, you compile in the static paradigm where you execute classical portions of your program, or you specify program inputs, and you resolve the control flow in order to generate fully specified circuits. On the other hand, for OIR, it's intended to use with static compilation where we can't resolve control flow until much later. So we have to contend with a lot of unknowns, such as user input or dynamic loop bounds, dynamic branching conditions, and we rely on static program analysis and optimization. And the downside of this, of course, that some optimizations may not be caught at compile time, simply due to the lack of information. But the upside is that it's very efficient in terms of the representation of the program and in terms of the algorithms that run on this representation. And we can do this work in advance, this optimization and compilation, and reducing the overhead once we want to run the program. So we'll see with the benchmarks later why this static system will likely be important for quantum programs in the future. So we had to do some work to expose the quantum data flow alongside the classical data flow in the IR and the SSA graph. And I want to talk about that here. In the input, I said we were dealing with these qubit references, and the data flow is not explicit between the operations. But for the qubit data type, we immediately get this data flow for free by lowering to the optimization dialect. So as mentioned before, these operations are now linked via useDef chains. And this is really great, but for registers, it's a lot trickier. The problem is that SSA is fundamentally designed for scalars. And so for arrays and memory locations, it's much more difficult to represent the data relationship statically. So the size of the array may not be known, or it's even too large to represent each element individually with SSA values. So let's consider this same example, but using a register. We allocate this one register of 8 qubits, and then operations act on individual qubits by indexing this register. And if we naively transform this into this quantum SSA, we will get something like this, where we have a register state value, and every time an operation acts on any qubit in the register, a new state value for the entire register generated. So this would hide the data dependencies between the instructions on individual qubits. So instead of doing this, what we came up with is to make the data flow locally explicit using these extract and combine instructions. So what they do is they take out a qubit from a register, making the single qubit value available for operations to use, and then they put it back into the register. And initially, this is not very useful because each operation lives in their like own little bubble where they aren't linked between them. So we use static analysis to expand these regions of local data flow. And so what this looks like is we have this combine instruction, for example. It puts a qubit back into the register. And this is immediately followed on that same register by an extract operation where we take out a different qubit. And so here we can just delay putting the qubit back until the next combine instruction because it doesn't affect this qubit. So this would look something like this. And now this qubit value that we had, it lives on longer than before because it's only put back into the register later on. And so we keep going and we see that we put this qubit back in the zeroth position and then we take it back out immediately. So these operations just cancel. Now we can further just simplify this by combining successive extract operations, successive combine operations, if they act on the same register. And we end up with this nice expanded region where the data flow is explicit again. So we have this result value from this Hadamard gate, and it's used in this rotation gate here. Now we talked about optimizations and that we want to use this R for optimization. So let me show you an example of what these optimizations may look like. In MLR, we already get a lot of classical optimizations for free. So we can use inlining passes, we can use that code elimination, constant folding and so on. And we implemented some quantum optimization passes on our R. Such as Hermitian gate cancellation, so where you cancel, or like adjoint gate cancellation, where you cancel operations that are inverse to each other and successive in the SSA graph. You can merge parameterized operations. And we also do this across loop iterations. And so MLR provides this nice pattern rewriting framework that we can use to easily implement these quantum operations. And also many more. So these are what are known as people optimizations because they only look at a small section of the circuit. But you can implement any number of quantum optimizations that are out there in our IR. So an example of this that actually comes up in the benchmark that we did is this function here, which is a quantum function that adds a constant to register modulo n. And this is part of the Shor's algorithm. So at some point there is these subroutines which add a constant and subtract a different constant. And if we look at the inside of these subroutines, we see that they always start with a quantum Fourier transform and with the inverse of that quantum Fourier transform. And so if we inline these, we get this situation where there's a inverse QFT followed by QFT. And this is the ideal scenario for a pattern rewriter to go in and cancel these gates. Now, if there's some operations left where the return values go unused, we can use that code elimination to eliminate those as well. We also implemented a prototype resource estimation routine. And I want to briefly mention how this was done. So in these other frameworks that I mentioned earlier, you generate this full circuit and then you would count the gates that appear in the circuit and you would get the resource counts that way. And resource estimation is useful for quantum computing because you may want to know in advance how much resources your program is going to require when you run it on expensive quantum hardware. So what we do is, you have these quantum instructions in your program and you also have some classical control structure around it. And we simply replace the quantum instructions by counters. So for every gate type, there's a counter. And when you then execute this purely classical program that results from this, it spits out all the counters for the different resources that you have. This is it's a more efficient way of performing resource estimation than generating the whole circuit in Python and counting all the gates. So let's look at some benchmarks. As mentioned, we use Shor's algorithm as a benchmark. And we implement the Shor's algorithm directly in the input dialect of our IR. And we implemented the same way in Project Q and Qiskit as well as comparison. So for our IR, the code goes through a series of transformation passes that we already mentioned, like the dialect lowering, the quantum optimizations that we have, and then the resource estimation routine that we wrote. And then we use LLVM to compile and link an executable that counts the resources used of the program. And so what we measure is we measure the compile time and then the execution time separately to see how resources how computationally intensive these compilation tasks are. For the other frameworks, we try to achieve the very similar level of optimization that we have for fair comparison. So this is the result of measuring the runtime of the compilation routines. Our prototype Kiro, it has the compile time shown here, and as expected, because we don't have the program input yet, this is completely independent of the size of the input to the program. Now, this orange line here is the total compilation time plus the runtime of the resource estimation executable. And we see that it does scale, of course, with the program input. And then we also have Qiskit and Project Q. So if we look at the values here, Project Q, I stopped collecting data at 8 bits of input. And it took over 150 seconds to perform optimizations and get the resource counts. In Qiskit, at 11 bits of input, we already were at 75 seconds. And so in this regime, our prototype only takes about half a second. Now, if we extrapolate this to useful input sizes, say for cracking RSA at 2000 bits, we would get something like 10 to the 4 and 10 to the 3 years in Project Q and Qiskit respectively to run optimizations and get the resource counts compared to about a week in Kiro. And this is only if we care about resource estimation. So if we don't care about resource estimation, it will still only take half a second to optimize that program, even with 2000 bits, because it doesn't matter how many bits the input has. So this is really cool because it's very efficient to do these optimizations statically. But are they actually useful? So we compared the gate counts that we obtain in Project Q versus those that we obtain in Q with very similar optimizations. And we see that we have the people optimizations we implement in Q. And if we include those optimizations across loop iterations, we obtain a very similar optimization results as in Project Q, where Project Q does these optimizations on the full circuit. So it has more information available. And so this is very promising as a much more resource efficient way to optimize very large circuits. So in conclusion, we designed a novel intermediate quantum representation for program optimization, which focuses on classical quantum code integration. It focuses on reusing existing compilation infrastructure, and it focuses on scalability, aiming for application scale quantum programs. And it does so by exposing the quantum data flow alongside the classical data flow in the same IR and enabling static optimization on these programs. So the results of our benchmark is that 99.8% of savings obtained in Project Q can also be obtained statically in Kiro, while being much, much faster.